Hippolyta, our nuptial hours draw on apace. 4 happy days bring in another moon. But oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires.
4 days will quickly steep themselves in night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And then the moonlight to a silver bow, new bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnities.
Hippolyta, I wooed thee with my sword and won thy love doing the injury. But I will wed thee in another key. With pomp, with triumph, with reveling.
Happy be, Theseus, our renowned duke.
Thanks, good Aegis. What news says thee?
Full of vexation, come on. With complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia. Come, stand forth, Demetrius. My noble lord, this man has my consent to marry me. Stand forth, Lysander. My gracious duke, this man has bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, hast given a rhyme and interchanged love tokens with my child. Thou hast by moonlight sung with fading voice verses of feigning love and stolen the impression of a fantasy. With bracelets of thy hair, rings, God, conceit, with cunning, Lysander, thou hast filched my daughter's heart and turned her obedience, which is due to me, into stubborn harshness. My gracious duke, being so, she not before your grace consent to marry Demetrius, I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, I may dispose of her, which shall be either to this gentleman or to her death. According to our law, immediately provided.
What say you, Hermia? Be advised, fair maid. To you, your father should be as a god. Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
In himself he is. However, in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other should be made the worthier.
I would my father look but with my eyes.
No, rather your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, but I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death, or to abjure forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires if you yield not to your father's choice. You can endure the livery of a nun, chanting faint hymns at a cold, fruitless moon, to grow, live, and die in single blessedness.
So will I grow, so die, so live, my lord, before I will yield my virgin patent up unto his lordship, whose unwished yoke my soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause, and by the next new moon, the sealing day betwixt my love and me. Upon that day, either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or to marry Demetrius as he would. or on Diana's altar to protest for I austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia. And Lysander, yield thy grace title to my certain right.
You have his her father's wealth, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. You marry him.
Scornful, Lysander. Scornful. True. He has my love, and all that is mine, my love shall render to him. And she is mine, and all my right of her, I estate to me.
I am my lord, as well derived as he is well possessed.
No, you're not!
My fortunes are every way as fairly rated, if not with vanity.
No, they're not!
And what is more than all those boasts can be?
What?
I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my rights?
But you have none.
Demetrius, and I'll vouch it to his head, gave love to Nadar's daughter, Helena.
Say it not so!
And stole her heart. And she, sweet lady, dotes. Devoutly dotes. Dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess that I've heard so much. And with Demetrius thought to have spoke thereof, but being over full of self-affair, my mind did lose it. But Demetrius, come. And Edges, come. You shall go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. For you, fair Hermia, look. You arm yourself to fit your fancies of your father's will, or else the law of Athens will yield you up to death or to a vow of single life. Come, my Hippolyta. What cheer, my love? Do it.
Come the roses there do fade so fast.
Belike for want of rain, which I could well continue from the tempest of my eyes.
I forgot that I could ever read, could ever hear by tale or history. The course of true love never did come smooth. For either it was different in blood.
Oh, hell, to choose love by another's eyes.
Or if there was a sympathy in choice, war, death, or sickness could lay siege to it, making it momentary as a sound, swift as a shadow, as short as any dream. So quick, bright things come to confusion.
If then true lovers have ever been crossed, it stands as an edict in destiny. So let us teach our trial patience, because it is a customary cross, as due to love as thoughts and dreams and sighs, wishes and tears, poor fancy.
A good persuasion. Hear me, Hermia. I have a widowed aunt, a dowager. From Athens is her home remote 7 leagues. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee? For there the sharp Athenian laws cannot pursue us. And if thou lovest me, then steal forth thy father's house tomorrow night. And in the wood, a league outside of town, where I did meet thee once with Helena to do observance to a morn of May, there I will stay for thee.
My good Lysander, I swear to thee, by Cupid's strongest bow, by the simplicity of Venus' doves, by all the vows that ever men have broke, in number more than women ever spoke, in that same place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow, Juliet will be with thee.
Oh, keep promise, love, keep promise. Look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair loves your fair, oh happy fair. Oh, my ear should catch your voice, my eye your eye, my tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Were the world mine, Demetrius being baited, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius's heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
Oh, that your frown should teach my smile such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
Oh, that my prayers to such affections move.
His folly has no fault of mine.
Oh, none but your beauty, for that fault were mine.
He no more shall see my face. Lysander and myself will fly this place.
Fair Helena, to you our minds we will unfold. Tomorrow night, when Phoebe doth behold the silver visages on the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl on the bladed grass, that time when lovers doth strive to conceal, through Athens' gates we have devised to steal.
And in that wood, where you and I upon faint primrose beds had wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet, there my Lysander and myself shall meet. Farewell, sweet playfellow, pray thou for us. Oh, and good luck grant thee thy Demetrius.
Helena, I do. As you on him, Demetrius dote on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens I am thought as fair as she. But what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know what all but he do know. For ere Demetrius looked on Hermia's eyne, he hailed on oaths that he were only mine. And when the hailsome heat from Hermia felt, so he dissolved in showers of oaths did melt. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight. Then to the woods will he tomorrow night pursue her. And for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. For herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
We've got everything that we need. I'm pretty darn sure there's nothing else that we really need here. What is taking so long? Can we get it? This is amazing. You know what we have to do. Is all our company here?
You were best to call them generally, man by man, according to the script.
Here is a scroll of every man's name, which is thought fit through all of Athens to play in our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on his wedding day at night.
First, good Peter Quinn, say what the play treats on. Then, read the names of the actors, and so, grow to a point.
Ah, marry our play is the most lamentable of comedies, and the most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
Very good piece of work, I assure you, and a merry. Now, good Peter Quinn, call forth your actors by the scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answer as I call you. Nick Bottom the Weaver.
Ready. Name what part I am for and proceed.
Nick Bottom. You shall take Pyramus on you.
What is Pyramus? A lover? Or a tyrant?
Ah. 'Tis the lover that kills himself most gallantly for love.
That will ask some tears in the true performing of it. If I do it, let the audience look to their eyes. I will move storms. I will condole in some measure to the rest. Yet my chief humor is for a tyrant. The raging rocks and shivering sharks shall break the locks of prison gates, and Phoebus' car shall shine from far and make it mark the foolish fates! Yeah. Thank you. Yes. This is Locke. Now, name the rest of the players.
Where's Luke, the bell's men now? Here, Peter Quince.
Francis Bloom. You must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe? A wandering knight?
Ooh.
Ah,
It is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Hey, right? Let me not play a woman. I have a beard coming.
All is one. You may play it in a mask, and you may speak as smooth as you will.
Ooh, and I may have my face.
Let me play Thisbe.
I'll speak in a monstrous
little voice. Thisbe. Oh, Pyramus, lover dear. Thy Thisbe dear. And lady dear.
You may play no Papa Pyramus. And Bloop, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starling, the tailor. Hip turn, twins. Robin Starling, you. Pyramus is mine. Yes. Tom Snout, the tinker.
Help me, Twix!
You. Yes, you. Pyramus' father. Yes, father. Myself, Thisbe's father. Now, snug the Georgia, the lion's part, and here I hope a play fitted.
Tell me the lion's part, then. If it be, in me.
For I am slow, steady. You may do it extemporal, for it is nothing but roaring.
Yeah. Ooh, let me play the lion too. I will roar, that I will do any man's heart good to hear me. I will roar, that I will make the Duke say, let him roar again. Let him roar again.
You may play no part but Pyramus. See, look. You would roar too terribly that the Duchess and the ladies would shriek, and that were enough to hang us all.
They would hang us all, mother son.
I grant you, friends, if that you should fright the ladies out of their wits, they would have no more discretion but to hang us. But I will aggravate my voice so that I will roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I will roar you as for any nightingale.
You may play no part for Pyramus. But Pyramus is he's a sweet faced man. He's a gentleman-like man. He's a most lovingly like man. And you must needs play Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it.
Masters, here are your parts. I request you, I pray, call them by tomorrow night and meet me without the palace, a mile without town. And I pray you, fail me not.
We will meet, and there we may rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect, adieu! Yeah.
What's this? Yo, what's this? Money?
Over hill. Over dale. Brush. Briar. Over pork. Over hill. Blood. Through fire. We do wonder everywhere.
Oh, really?
Swifter than the bone spear. Wow. And we serve our fairy queen to do her once on the green.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, well, my spirits. Well, be gone.
Our queen and all our elves come here are none.
Yeah. You fairy.
The king keeps his rebels here tonight. Take heed, the queen come not within his sight. For Oberon is passing fell hat, because she has her attendant pack. A lovely boy stolen from an Indian king. She never had so sweet a changeling. And jealous Oberon would have that child. Knight of his train to trace the forest wild. But she perforce withholds the lovely boy. Crowns him with flowers and makes him all her joy.
Either we mistake your shape in making quite, yeah. Or else with that shooting name is Frank.
Frank, 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 Frank.
Bobby, good fellow. Oh, not you, oh. That frights the women, the maidens of the villagery. Skin milk, and sometimes labels in the current. And bootless makes the breathless housewives churn.
And sometimes make the drink to bear no barm. Mislead night wanderers, laughing at their harm. Close that hobgoblin. Call you and sweet butt. You do their work, and they shall have good luck.
Are not you me?
Hey, it's him.
Last week, Mr. Wright, I am that merry wanderer of the night. I jest Oberon to make him smile, while I am fat an infant horse of man. Name the likeness of a filly foal. Sometimes look I in a gossip's bowl, in the very likeness of a crab. And when she drinks against her lips, I bob. And in her withered dewlap spill I the air. The wisest aunt, tell the saddest tale. Sometimes mistake is a 3 foot stool.
Yes, yes.
Slip I from her bump, down double she. And the tailor cries and breaks into a cough. And the entire choir hold their hips and laugh. But room, spirit. Here comes Oberon.
And here are Miss. That he was gone,
mistress.
This is a
go.
Ill lit by moonlight, proud.
What? Jealous Oberon? Spirits, skip head. I have forsworn his bed and company.
Halt, you rash wanton! Am not I thy lord?
Oh, then I must be thy lady. But I know when thou has stolen away from spirit land and in the shape of Corin sat all day playing on pipes of corn and versing love to amorous Milena.
Why art thou here? Come from the farthest steps of India, but that forsooth the bouncing Amazon, your buskin mistress and your warrior love, to Theseus must be wedded. And you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How can thou thus for shame, Titania, glance at my credit with the holiday, knowing that I know of thy love to Theseus? Did thou not lead him through the glimmering night from Perigenia, whom he ravished?
Yeah.
And make him with fair Agrigus break his vow to Ariadne and Antiope?
These are the forgeries of jealousy. And never, since the middle summer spring, met we on hill, in dale, by forest or mead, by rushy fountain or by rushy brook, or in the beached margin of the sea, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls, thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore, the seasons alter. Childing autumn, angry winter, change their wonted liveries, and the mazed world by their increase now knows not which is which. And this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Then you amended them. It lies in you. Why should my heart cross her over? I do but beg a little change to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The spirit land buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order. But she, being mortal, of that boy did die. And for her sake do I rear up her boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long in this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day, if you will patiently dance in our round and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me, and I will spare your haunts.
Give me the boy, and I will go with thee.
Not for the spirit kingdom. Spirit away! We shall chide them right to my longer stay.
Well, go thy way, then. Thou shalt not from this grove until I torment thee for this injury. You. My gentle pup, come hither. Thou rememberest that once I sat upon a promontory and heard a mermaid riding on the dolphin's back, uttering such dulcet and harmonious breath that the rude sea grew civil to hear her song. And certain stars shot madly from their spears to hear the sea maid's music.
I remember.
That same time I saw Falcon's Knight riding between the cold moon and the earth. Cupid, all armed. A certain name he took at a fair virgin throned in the west, and loosed his love shaft smartly from his bow as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. And missed. Yet, I marked where the bolt of Cupid fell. It fell upon a little western cloud, before milk white, now purple with love's womb. And the maidens call it love in idleness.
Aphrodisia!
Fetch me that flower. This herb I showed thee once, the juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid, will make man or woman madly dote on the first live creature that it sees.
Put a girdle around the earth in 40 minutes.
Yeah! Having once this juice, I'll watch Titania while she is asleep. Taste the liquor of it on her eyes. The next thing wakened, she then looks upon, be it a lion, a bear, a wolf, a bull, a meddling monkey, or a busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love.
Demetrius!
Who goes there? I am invisible.
I love thee not. Therefore, pursue me not.
Oh, you draw me, you hard-hearted adamant.
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, do I not, in plainest truth, tell you I do not, nor I cannot love you?
And even for that, do I love you the more?
Tempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I do look upon thee.
And on you.
You heat your modesty too much to leave the city and commit yourself into the hands of one that loves you not.
Your virtue is my privilege, and for that it is not night when I do see your face. Therefore I think I am not in the night, nor doth this wood lack worlds of company, for you in my respect are all the world.
I will run from thee and hide me in the brake, and leave thee to the mercy of wild beasts.
The wildest hath that such a heart as you. Run when you will, the story shall be changed. Apollo flies and Daphne holds the chase. The dove pursues the griffin, the mild hind makes speed to catch the tiger. Rawr! Bootless speed, when cowardice pursues and valor flies.
Let me go. I will not say thy question.
No.
What thou doest follow, do not believe, but I shall do thee mischief in the woods.
Aye, in the temple, the field, the town, you do me mischief. Fie, Demetrius! Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed, and we're not meant to woo. Oh, follow thee, and make a heaven of hell.
Helena! Yeah, he do fly this crow, and thou shalt fly after him, but he shall seek thy love.
Come back. Any kind of fool could see.
Has that
been you?
I pray thee, give it me.
One.
it's so amazing to be loved. Titania will follow you to the moon and the stars above. I knew a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and nodding violets grow. There sleeps Titania. Sometime in the night, lulled in these flowers with dances of delight. And with the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasy. Take thou some of it and seek through this grove a sweet Athenian lady in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes. But do it so that the next thing he espies may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garment he hath on. Affect it with some care. He may grow more fond of her than she upon her love. And look thou meet me here, the first cock crow.
Fear not, my lord. Your servants shall do so.
Yes. Ah!
And a lullaby. Sing me now to sleep. Oh, the dear offices, and let me rest.
If I say there's a ocean in the sky where my mind wish to be amongst the clouds, resting on the belly of the sea, would you hear with me?
Fair love, you faint with wandering in the wood. and to speak truth, I have forgot our way. We'll rest us, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander. Find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both. One heart, one bed, two bosoms, and one troth.
Nay, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, why further off yet? Do not lie so near.
Take the sense sweet of my innocence. Love takes its meaning from love's conference. I mean that my heart unto yours be knit, so that but one heart we can make of it.
Lysander riddles very prettily, but gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off.
Yeah.
In human modesty.
Amen, amen to that fair prayer, say I, and then end life when I end loyalty. Here's my bed. Sleep, give thee all his rest.
With half that wish, the wisher's eyes be blessed.
Through the forest have I gone. Pinion have I found none.
Whose eyes I might approve this flower's force and stirring love.
Night in silence!
Who is here? Well.
Clothes of Athens he doth wear. This is he, my master said, despised the Athenian maid.
And here is the maiden sleeping sound. Dank and dirty ground.
Pretty soul.
She does not lie near this lack of this kill cut aside.
Churl!
Upon thy eyelids I bestow all the power this charm doth owe. When thou wakest, let love forbid sleep his seat upon thy eyelid, and awaken when I am gone, for I must to Oberon. Come on!
Ah. Good.
Stay! So thou kill me, sweet Demetrius!
I charge thee, hence! Do not haunt me thus!
Oh, I am out of breath in this fond chase. The more of my prayers, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia, wheresoever she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. But I am as ugly as a bear, for beasts that meet me run away through fear. Who lies here? Lysander, on the ground, dead or asleep? Why, I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake.
And run through fire. I will, for thy sweet sake, transparent Helena, nature shows art that through thy bosom I can see thy heart.
Where is Demetrius? How fit a word is that vile name that will perish on my sword?
But do not say so, Lysander, say not so. What though he love your Hermia, lord? What though that Hermia still loves you? Then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent the tedious minutes I have with her spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Who would not change a raven for a dove?
wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? When at your hands did I deserve such scorn? Is it not enough? Is it not enough, young man, that I did never know nor never will deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye? But you must flout my insufficiency? Oh, that a lady of one man refused should of another therefore be abused!
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there. And never mayest thou come to Lysander near. For as the surfeit of the sweetest things, the deepest loathing to the stomach brings. Or as to heresies that men do leave, are hated most by those they did deceive. And thee, my surfeit and my heresy, of all be hated, but the most of me. With almighty power, for her love and might, to honor Helena and to be her knight.
Help me, Lysander, help me. Do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast. Lysander? What? Removed? Lysander! Lord! What? Out of hearing? Gone? No sound, no word? Alack! Where are you? Speak, and if you hear, speak of all loves! My swoon almost with fear! No? Then I well perceive you are not nigh. Either death or you I'll fight immediately.
Are we all met?
Pat, here is a marvelous and convenient place to borrow us. This green plot can be our stage.
Ooh. This hawthorn brick. This could be our tiring house.
Ah. And we shall do it in action as we would before the Duke.
Yeah! Peter Quince.
What sayest thou, Bully Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself with.
Yes.
The ladies cannot abide. How answer you that?
By lacking fearless feet!
I believe we must leave the killing out when all's done.
Not a whit. I have advice to make all well. Write me a prologue, and let this prologue seem to say, we will do no harm with our swords. This will put them out of fear.
Will not the ladies be afeard of a lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Masters, you ought to consider with yourself to bring in God shield us. A lion among ladies is a most dreadful thing.
Therefore, another prologue must tell you he is not a lion.
Nay, you must name his name. And he himself must be through saying, ladies, or fair ladies, I would wish thee, or I would entreat thee, not to fear, not to tremble, my life for yours. If you think I come hither as a lion, no, I am no such thing. I am a man, as other men are, and tell them plainly, he has bottomed Snug the joiner.
Well, it shall be so, but there are two hard things. That is that moonlight must shine into the chamber, so says the story, Pyramus and Thisbe do meet by moonlight.
Go! The moon shine! At night, we play our play!
A calendar, look in the almanac, find out moonshine.
find out moonshine.
Yes, it does shine that night!
Why, then may you leave a casement to the great chamber window where we play open, and the moon may shine in at the casement.
Ah, or someone may come in with a lantern and present it the person of moonshine. Then there's another thing. We must have a wall in the chamber. For, as the story goes, Pyramus and Thisbe do talk through the chink of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall! What say you, Bottom?
Some man or other must present wall. And let him have some plaster. Or some loam. And let him hold his fingers thus. And through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe
whisper!
Well, that may be, well, but we're going to, what we're going to do is we're going to allow this to happen, and we need to get a rehearsal done. Yeah, we need to get a rehearsal done. So, masters, listen.
You begin.
Pyramus, stand forward. Thisbe, Pyramus, you begin.
What have you homespuns have when you swagger here, so dear, the cradle of the fairy queen?
Pyramus, begin. Thisbe, stand forward.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor sweet.
Odors.
Odor savor sweet. So hath thy breath, thy dearest Thisbe dear. But hark, a voice! Stay thou but here a while, and by, I will to thee appear.
A stranger Pyramus, I never
see. Stranger!
Must I speak now?
Ah, Mary, must you? You must understand that he goes to see the noise that he heard and is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus! Most radiant Pyramus! Most radiant Pyramus! Most lily white of hue, of color like the red rose on triumphant briar. Most frisky juvenile, and it most lovely too. As true as horse that yet would never tire. I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Nina's tomb.
Nina's tomb, man. Nina's tomb. Pyramus, your cue is past. It is never tire.
I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at
Nina's tomb.
What do I see? Hold me!
What do you see? You see an asset of your own, do you?
Oh, bless me, Father! Thou art translated!
Nice.
I see their knavery. This is to make an ass of me. Frighten me if they could. But I will not stir from this place. I will walk up and down here, and I will sing that they shall hear I am not afraid. The owl so cock, so black of hue, with orange tawny bill, the grosso with his note so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flowery bed?
The finch, the sparrow, and the lark, the plain song cuckoo gray, whose note full many a man doth mark, and dares not answer nay. For indeed, who would set his wit to so foolish a bird? Who would give a bird the lie, though we cry cuckoo never so?
I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again. Mine ear is much enamored of thy note. is my eye enthralled to thy face? And thy fair virtues force perforce doth move me on the first view to say, to swear, I love thee.
Methinks, mistress, you should have little reason for that. And yet, to say the truth, reason and love keep little company together nowadays.
Thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so neither, but if I had wit enough to get out of this wood, I'd have enough to serve mine own turn.
Out of this wood do not desire to go. Thou shalt remain here, whether thou wilt or no. I am a spirit of no common rate. The summer still doth tend upon my state. And I do love thee. Therefore, go with me. I'll give thee spirits to attend on thee, and they shall fetch thee jewels from the deep and sing whilst thou on pressed flowers doth sleep. And I will cure thy mortal grossness so that thou shalt like an airy spirit go. Peace, Blossom! Come with Moth and Mustard Seed!
Ready!
And I.
And I.
And I. Be kind and courteous to this gentleman. Ow! Hop in his locks and gamble in his eyes. Feed him with apricots and dewberries, with purple grapes, green figs and mulberries, and pluck the wings from painted butterflies to fan the moonbeams from his sleeping eyes. Nod to him else and do him courtesy.
Hail, mortal!
Hail!
Hail!
I cry your worship's mercy heartily. I beseech your worship's name.
Cobweb?
I shall desire you a more acquaintance, good Master Cobweb. If I cut my finger, I shall make bold with thee. Your name, honest gentleman?
Peas Blossom.
I pray you commend me to Mistress Squash, your mother, and to Master Peascod, your father. Good Master Peas Blossom, I shall desire your more acquaintance, too. Your name, I beseech you, sir.
I'm Mustard Seed, I'm right here.
Good Master Mustard Seed, I promise you, your kindred had made my eyes water ere now. I shall desire your more acquaintance, good Master Mustard Seed.
Come, come, wait upon him, lead him to my bower. The moon, methinks, looks with a watery eye, and when she weeps, weeps every little flower, lamenting some enforced chastity. Tie up my love's tongue. Bring him silently.